better. Okay, good. So welcome, and I, as I say, couldn't be more delighted to welcome everyone here, both because these incredible women who are behind me I know well, and it's going to be an extraordinary conversation given the intellectual capital on stage. I also want to acknowledge that the organizers of the event, Harriet Warm is on our board and an incredibly valuable leader here, a former board president. So having an event that she's affiliated with is also very special. And just to say also that the whole content of the program tonight, to talk about the importance of design and architecture and urban planning, is so central to MoCA's vision. We are just about to arrive at our fifth anniversary in this building. And if anyone else has that gasp that I do, which is, oh my God, how can it be 5 years? But it has been, and we, every day that we're in this building, we are so proud that we were able to create it. And more importantly, once it is has been open, that it's been a site for incredible gatherings that have been, I think, really deepened the public value of what art and culture and architecture and design can do for the community. So for that, I'm grateful to be here and to have you all be here. Thank you.
Good evening. How is this? Thank you, Jill. And thank you all for coming to this very first Fresh Talk outside of Washington, D.C. I'm Barbara Richter, founder and co-chair of the Ohio Advisory Group of the National Museum of Women in the Arts. We are the exclusive Ohio affiliate of the Washington, D.C.-based Women's Museum and the organizers of tonight's Fresh Talk. We are immensely grateful to Lillian Kuri and and the Cleveland Foundation for supporting this program, and to Sally Grease of Grease Financial for her generosity, and to Jill Snyder of MoCA Cleveland for her support and gracious welcome to this iconic museum. Designed by international superstar and woman architect Farshid Mousavi, MoCA continues to inspire accolades around the world, and we could not think of a more exciting and fitting venue for tonight's Fresh Talk about the arts, urban design, and social change. Created by the National Museum for Women in the Arts, the Women Arts and Social Change Initiative and its Fresh Talk programs highlight the power of women as catalysts for change. Fresh Talks convene thought leaders, innovators, and engage audiences in creative conversations on wide-ranging topics, including design, gender, equity, the environment, economic opportunity, and so much more. Tonight, our speakers are exceptional women who are reinventing the landscape of Cleveland while taking part in a national and international dialogue about the impact of urban design and public art on our lives and economies. Your programs provide bios for our distinguished guests and also our moderator, Susan Fisher Sterling, a Cleveland native who comes to us from Washington and is the director of the Women's Museum, and we're so thrilled to have her here. So to set the stage for the conversation, Lillian Kuri, Vice President for Strategic Initiatives, Arts and Urban Design at the Cleveland Foundation, will kick us off with remarks, and then Susan will jump in and engage our speakers for the following 40 or 45 minutes. And now, to share a few words on your role during the Catalyst Cocktail Hour, I give you Harriet Warm. Thank you.
Hello. I'm pleased to be with you. I am the other founder and co-chair of the Ohio Advisory Group. And my job is to provide you with what I think of as a roadmap of the hour from 7 to 8. This is the hour when we hear from you. We were overwhelmed by the immediate and enthusiastic response when we announced this program, and it's wonderful to have all of you here tonight, but we want to broaden the impact of this evening, so we are now streaming the conversation live on YouTube. But those of you in this room have a unique opportunity to share your thoughts and lend your voice to the conversation directly. During the Catalyst Cocktail Hour, we ask you to join a table or find a seat. There'll be couches and tables with chairs as well as the high tops. Each area, each table, and the couch areas will have a tent card with intriguing questions to spark a conversation. Our speakers will circulate, so you'll have a chance to question them and to engage in an active dialogue. We encourage you to move among the tables from time to time, whenever you're ready for a new perspective. We also invite you to fill out our Can I Quote You cards so we can share your ideas with a wider audience. Because we all need fuel to rev up our creative engines, each of you has a drink ticket for one beer, wine, or soft drink. After that, you're on your own, but the bar will stay open until 8 p.m. We're also providing an array of hors d'oeuvres. We look forward to hearing from you. And now, let the program begin.
Good evening. First, I really want to thank the National Museum of Women in the Arts for hosting this event here in Cleveland. And on behalf of the Cleveland Foundation, we are really honored to sponsor this panel and discussion. I want to especially thank the Ohio Advisory Committee for the opportunity to shine a light on what this community has been doing in design. I know many of the members are here, and so thank you. I really thank you for this. I also want to really thank Barbara and Eliza, and I know Eliza's here as well, who I worked with along the way in organizing this event, and it's been such a pleasure working with you both. We're also really honored to have Susan Sterling here, the director of the museum. She is from Cleveland, as you heard. And very early in her career, she interned at the Cleveland Area Arts Council, if anyone remembers that, with Nina Gibbons, which was one of the early great proponents of public art in the region. She also interned in architectural firms here, and she says that her love of public art, architectural preservation, and architecture, and urban design was really nurtured here in Cleveland. So thank you, and we really welcome you here. I know I'm preaching to the choir in this audience because I recognize a lot of you, but to the national organization, you are in the right city and you're here in the right time, where innovation in the arts and design going on here is an exemplar nationally and even internationally, both in terms of the leadership represented by this panel, and I'm going to speak a little bit about these women and their leadership, but also by the design that has been going on here in Cleveland. It is really leading edge work, and we're happy to really have you share this with the national audience. I was struck by the mission of the museum, who states that their mission is to bring light to remarkable women artists of the past while promoting the best women artists working today. So in that context, this panel and the work represented by this book, this group of women over the last 15 years, represent some of the most remarkable work of women leaders in design in one city collectively that I know of. I can't think of another city that has a collection of women, not only on this stage, but in this audience, who have been working so hard to revitalize this city. And before we jump into the panel and the discussion questions, I really wanted to introduce these colleagues in a personal way. I think they're really nervous about this. And I believe I want to do it because I want to define for you what I think are the characteristics of leadership in design. So first I'll start with Anne. Anne, really, most of you know her, but for me, she stepped in to lead some of the largest civic projects of our time when no one else was willing or even could realize them. She has done more to transform the way we value public space than probably anyone in the history of Cleveland. She has transformed more public space, both in quantity and in quality than I think anyone will for generations to come. It's truly remarkable. And Jennifer was the first woman in this city's history to be the chair of both the Design Review and the Landmarks Commission at the same time. And under her tenure as the chair of both, she provided much needed leadership at a time when there was very little design leadership in government. She did so when some of our most important civic projects were under consideration and development. I would argue that in addition to raising the bar on design, equally important, she fought to prevent some of the near disastrous design decisions that could have been made. Yes, that deserves clapping. That really would. But one of the most important legacies for me about her time was how she was able to strike a balance, an extraordinary balance, between historic preservation while encouraging new contemporary design culture for Cleveland. Her tenure, vision, and willingness to use her voice publicly as the chair of both of these bodies has an undeniable impact on this generation of design in our city. And Terry, there is no other way to describe Terry Schwarz other than a visionary thinker. Never afraid to use the platform of the Urban Design Center to keep us all at a higher level. I would argue that she has and is currently responsible for preventing us from making not just 50, but 100-year mistakes in planning. She is always pushing publicly for new ways to approach big civic ideas. She has researched, developed a body of work that represents the best national thinking about vacancy as a new kind of resource and large system thinking about stormwater. Her work is having an impact here and also nationally and internationally. And representative of this, as we were all preparing for this panel, she of course proposed to us that today we should talk about big ideas and projects that have not yet been realized. She's always pushing us to the future. And last but certainly not least, Marika. If you know Marika, then you know that she is ahead of all of us. She is using her fearless, innovative spirit and understanding of place and people to make a new kind of change in Cleveland. Her work and impact in Hingetown demonstrates a new model of socially responsible market rate development. It sits at the nexus of social entrepreneurship, placemaking, and design. In some regards, she has created transformation in a neighborhood with very little traditional philanthropy. It has been done by young people with a new civic development way, not a top-down traditional community development that we have been used to. Her work, while it's rooted in Hingetown, she keeps us all connected to the world. Through her firm's professional work in education and healthcare in emerging countries, she represents the generational shift in design and planning. We need to pay close attention and learn from her. So before I turn it back over to Susan, I wanted to say that for me, these four women are remarkable, but they represent the ingredients that I think are important to the field, but they're not taught. They are that these women have an equal balance of vision and doing. They demonstrate bold risk-taking with practical strategic thinking. This is not straight-line work. They are all fighting in a space where no one else is fighting, this messy civic space where change is made. They've all been insisting, fighting, and making the norm in Cleveland a better quality design. They're collaborative. At one time or another, we've all had each other's back, supporting each other and willing to share credit. So having this many leaders, both on this panel and in this room, makes me hopeful that as we as a community wrestle with social justice issues in the arts and design in this city, and the pressures that will come from development that will create some questions about equitable cities, I know that we'll tackle this work head on and in new ways. I'm truly honored to be here in Cleveland at this time with this group of women that I call my friends, colleagues, my mentors, that I've learned so much from, and that together in the trenches, we've been doing this work for a really long time. So welcome.
Thank you to all of you for coming tonight and to talk with this distinguished a panel of professionals. One of the slides you'll see, which is really ugly, but it was what I had, was from the Architectural Biennale, the 15th Architectural Biennale in Venice this past year, called Reporting from the Front. Now, keep that in mind, because if we get to the end, or perhaps during the question, when we break for the Catalyst Cocktail Hour, I'd like to think about Front International, which is the new program that is being developed for a triennial here in Cleveland. But the slides, just so you know, are a cavalcade. It's a nice old-time term. We are using it in a diagonal way. It segments the program, but you'll see the pictures from time to time, but they don't have anything to do with what we're going to talk about, except at least they're not going to be synchronized. So that sort of fits with the building, and I think that will be really great. What I wanted to say about the biennial that was in Venice this past year is it was developed by Chilean architect Alejandra Aravena, and it was about the social conscience of architecture. And it fits in well with things that Lillian was talking about. It was actually similar to Okwe and Weisar's art biennial before that, which also looked at social justice and social conscience. And Aravena believes that the advancement of architecture is not a goal in itself, but a way to improve people's quality of life. His definition of architecture is giving form to place where people live, the larger context, and he uses the front as a battle analogy. His work is, yes, he acknowledges that stark architects or iconic buildings are important, but he really was talking about the awareness of societal needs and the vast parts of the built environment that are beyond the usual purview of professional architects. He says that architecture is just one piece of the decision, that government and decision makers, funders, developers must be involved in the process, and people must be involved. This biennial really helps to situate Cleveland at the forefront of the idea that architects, planners, and architecture and cities are ready to resume the mission of building a better world through their work. And he uses General Creighton Abrams' joke when he talks about this work of how do you eat an elephant? I know many of you are probably familiar with this joke. How do you eat an elephant? And Cleveland is like this. One bite at a time. You take it one bite at a time. Or as Bill Gates tells it, according to Ann Zoller, we overestimate what we can do in 1 year and underestimate what we can accomplish in 10. So from these macro lenses, let's find out how our panelists have contributed to the rethinking, redesigning, and repurposing of public spaces and the experience of living in Cleveland. So Jennifer, I'd start with you. And this is going to be a call and response. Each person is going to be given a question, but others on the panel are going to feel free to jump in. So Jennifer, how can or does the government process, the public process, inform and also change?
Well, it's been very interesting. I started on the Landmarks Commission and the Design Review in 2005. And for architecture, we would meet every 2 weeks at City Hall. It was mostly kind of a sleepy affair. Projects came in front of us. We'd act on them one way or the other, or maybe send someone home to do a little bit more work on projects. By the time I left in 2015, the media was there every week. Many of you, many folks, especially young folks, were there to learn. And I thought that was one of the most critical thing is the importance of urban design and the environment that people live in became larger than architects or designers or urban planners. It was really something where people wanted to see the decisions that were happening to their city. And that was always beautiful to see, you know, a full, instead of just the architects who are planning and owners of projects, to see people who are coming in to learn about the process and also to inform if it was their neighborhood that was going to be affected by a particular building. So on that hand, the public public impact, especially in Cleveland, but I suspect that this has been really nationwide, has put more eyes, if you will, on the public process. Just as, you know, coming from this, from practicing architecture for a couple of decades, it was a very sort of straightforward process for me. Use the history experience that I knew to look at projects and make suggestions if they needed it to become a better project and really tie into the context of where this building was going to be, whether it's locally or on a civic level. Things change. Projects change. A lot of times what we were looking for, and even in the Planning Commission, is sort of the system. I became really interested and almost fascinated in not just in the design, the aesthetics of the building, or the historic preservation aspect of it, but how this building, the system that it was fitting in its either new building or within how it was being transformed into a use that was going to be for this time and place. That actually led very much to my interest in being on the philanthropic part, because that's when you see a lot of changes. Ultimately, you can make aesthetic suggestions or historic suggestions on the application of the preservation, but sometimes projects needed something on the back end that didn't have that much to do with the architecture or how it was built or how it looks. So, you know, at a couple of meetings, I remember thinking, gee, I just wish, you know, we had gotten to this project before the architect was hired and the contractor was hired and money was actually placed on this to look at some of the ideals behind why this building was being built or renovated. So boom, and then, you know, I'm at a foundation, so I get to do kind of what that sort of impossible thought that was in my head. But Cleveland has been very interesting, I think, number one, because of the public's interest and especially the young people's interest in the built environment. And that all sort of is a groundswell, and it really has changed in some ways or affected how City Hall operates. And that's whether it's preservation, whether it's landmarks, whether it's design, whether it's planning, whether it's zoning. BZA is really taking a really critical position in what's happening in the city and our codes itself. So we're starting to see so many different and interesting, fascinating things, how they all work together within the city.
If I could just add on to that, I think one of the things from the perspective of someone who has helped to drive projects is the quality of the folks on these design bodies. When you've got Lillian and Jennifer, who are true stakeholders in this community, and so you're not just presenting in front of them, but both of these bodies, both planning, the Planning Commission and Design Review, have really encouraged for a large civic endeavor that there's a lot of community discussion around it. These members come. You don't just see them on Friday at the presentations. And I really, you know, Jennifer, I think for years and years with the group plan in Public Square, there was never a meeting that we asked you to attend that you didn't. And so what really changes things is when you have Planning Commission members and Design Review Committee members who understand the impact of their work and are willing to invest as people. It completely changes the dynamic then when you go to present. It really becomes much more of a what does this city need, what's your role, what's my role, and how together can we make sure that we're moving things forward.
So I'm totally unencumbered by knowledge when I ask this question. Is there an overall planning body, or is it a patchwork of groups?
For the city, do you mean?
I mean, a nice, of course, a collegial and very appreciative patchwork of group that works very well together all the time, and it's just fantastic and loves each other, like in every city.
Yeah, it's very much like in every city, I would say. I think the one of the important things about why we've had so much progress over the last 10 or 15 years, and there's a lot of reasons for that, but I think it has to do with the people and the leadership and the commitment to get this kind of work done. So I think it lies squarely in the people, some of the leaders here, but some of the others in this room who have kind of driven things to get done. Go hell or high water, we're gonna do this and we're gonna do it really well and we're gonna work together to do it. And so that's been an attitude, I think, that's here. And I think in some ways, design review and government, as far as some of these projects, has supported that work versus standing in its way, which has been good.
That's great. So, Ann, I know that you're one of your biggest projects recently has been the public square. Mm-hmm. And I wanted to ask you, how has art and design been that social change catalyst in your work, and how have you seen it in recent projects?
Well, that's, I mean, that's a big question. It's a big project, and I think, you know, the thing is, Public Square has been so transformative, and it's a project that many of the people on the stage, you know, not just the organization I used to run, but, you know, we worked on that for 15 years, and we were slogging it along with all of these, you know, the folks on this stage. It didn't happen by accident. And I think one of the things that is so important is that when we saw the opportunity, we looked around and we saw what other cities were doing in terms of investing in public spaces, we looked at the need to transform at a world-class level. And it wasn't just to get it done and check a box. And so with, again, philanthropic support, you know, the first dollars in to bring, you know, to have a design competition so that some of the best designers in the world would consider this opportunity, with the support of the foundation community, we were able to do that. And we, you know, as an organization, Land Studio, really stood behind the importance of design. Jennifer talked about the political process or the public process. There was an extensive, you know, decades-long community process so that we were able to bring the best, you know, James Cornerfield Operation, one of the world's renowned landscape architects, to the table. But it wasn't their vision, it was really dissecting what Clevelanders wanted to see in this public space. And so when you look at how social change has happened, and the really, you know, the photos that are rotating up there, there's one that's just a beautiful one of nuns in habits, and I didn't know they wore them anymore, and I would know I went to Catholic school for 12 years, you know, outside the fountain with kids of every stripe. And the thing that was just so amazing about what happened with Public Square was it really became a public square. It went from this thing where we talked about public square, where it truly became the city's living room. And we were so worried about having protests and having it be really the centerpiece for the RNC, because what could happen? But what happened was social change happened in the most profound, beautiful way. And I will say, in part because we were so deliberate about how Clevelanders wanted to see that space used, how it was designed, and through all of the challenges that we had during construction, and there were many, we never once considered value engineering the things that counted. And so, you know, as an organization, we fought for the integrity of the design. We've got several funders in the audience, and I think they would agree with me. It's easier to raise money for something at a world-class level than it is for mediocrity. And what we see is that the quality of that, and you may not, you know, to the average eye, people just look and see how the space has been transformed, but it's the thoughtfulness and how it was intended to breathe, be lungs for the city, encourage use, casual use, large civic use. There's a genius to that that really allows that place to be a true public square. And then social change happens all by itself.
I would totally agree with that, because I remember when I was young, I would walk over to the Rockefeller building from Terminal Tower, and I would walk around Public Square. And when I was here for a tour with a group from the Women's Museum earlier this year, I actually was staying in a place where I walked into Public Square because it asked me to. Right. It absolutely opened its arms to me, and for the first time in decades, I thought of it as a space that I could feel myself in.
And you know, we talked for years about this will be a place for all Clevelanders, and it is. You know, and it, because it calls and invites people from every neighborhood in the city, from every economic level. People feel invited, they feel embraced, they feel that they can come together as a community and be neighbors. And that is, it's unlike anything we've ever had.
And what's amazing is that it actually is living up to how it was envisioned back in 1790 when the city was founded. And, you know, the space has historically been always a bed of controversy. It really still is. I don't know if it ever will not be, for different reasons that have to do with the history of the city and what was happening in the city at that time. So I think at this point, you know, it's sort of a magical point where it's really living up to, number one, what we are envisioning ourselves as a 21st century city is. And it's just beginning to start to realize some of those objectives.
Well, I especially liked the fact that I had read an article where a very big naysayer said, well, how can we compare with Millennium Park in Chicago? And when I went into the space for the first time, I said, well, you don't have to worry about that. There's no comparison. It is what it is for this place. And it's the large scale kind of vision that you want to see in cities. And I can even say, living near the mall in Washington, that there's an emptiness to it compared to the vibrancy of the space at the square. I wanted to change to from the larger, big public space that has that sort of presence all its life, to talking about Hingetown, which when I was first starting to think about it, I said, where is Hingetown? I've never heard this name. I mean, I know Buckeye, and I know Glenville, and I know all kinds of parts of the city, Ohio City, but I never heard of Hingetown. And then, of course, I did my reading, and I realized that's because it's a new name. And sometimes when you name a place, it really does start to make all the difference. So, Marika, I wanted to ask you how your work, along with your partner, Graham, it creates a collective effort that improves the quality of life, builds connectivity, and tolerance and understanding among neighbors and among neighborhoods. Can you speak to that a bit?
Yeah, definitely. And I think when you were talking earlier about for the first time wanting to walk through Public Square, I think that's exactly kind of one of the big goals that Graham and I, who's in the audience, were really thinking about when we started. We kind of came up with this wacky idea of coming up with this new name for this area. So Hingetown is a kind of micro hood within Ohio City. We've got some OCI people in the audience. You know, Graham and I have both lived in a lot of different cities. I actually had recently moved from Oakland, California, when I moved to Cleveland 4.5 years ago, and was really interested in thinking about how we could kind of create this sort of micro catalyst in the urban fabric to really promote walking and connectivity. So we came up with this name Hingetown, which was really named because it was sitting at the hinge between the sort of Market District of Ohio City, Gordon Square Arts District, and the Warehouse District downtown, each of which is really within a 10-15 minute walk from where Hingetown is. But you know, when we first moved into this firehouse at 29th and Church Street, people thought we were crazy if we wanted to walk to Gordon Square, which, if you're comparing that to a comparable neighborhood in New York City or the Bay Area, it's they're so close, and yet they feel so far away. And we had read this book called Walkable City, which really talks about this idea of missing teeth in urban fabric, so things like empty lots, you know, sort of abandoned buildings, things that make a street less enjoyable to walk down, and kind of creates this atmosphere where everybody wants to drive everywhere. And so we started thinking about what could we do to really try to promote this idea of walking, using public transportation, create kind of a bit of an urban node that then ideally would start to sort of fill in some of these missing teeth and start to create a more kind of connected and vibrant Near West Side urban fabric. So that's what we really set out to do, developing the firehouse, and then a building catty corner. The transformer station moved in right across the street from the firehouse, which was, you know, probably the best coincidence we ever could have imagined or not imagined. And we've really been able to work very closely with a lot of the neighborhood partners there to start to kind of envision what could this neighborhood be, working really collaboratively with OCI, with a lot of partners, now with Spaces Gallery, who's moved in, the Inner Museum Art, Conservation Association. So it's really started to become a bit of a node that cares about art and public space. And one project that I think I'm most proud of that we've worked on recently, with really generous funding from Lillian and real leadership with Lillian, was the Creative Fusion public art project that we worked on back in fall 2016. We were able to convince Lillian to have really all six artists, but six artists, six international artists, and six local artists, each work on a public art piece right in the Hingetown area. And we really kind of championed bit of a change in how the grant was funded so that we were able to pay for commissions for local artists as well as international artists, and think of ways for them to work together and collaborate on different pieces. And they showed up in a lot of different ways, from smaller scale vinyl pieces that went on the sides of smaller buildings to Ananda Nahu's really incredible piece. She's a Brazilian artist. I have one of her pictures up. She created, I think, one of the largest, if not the largest, public art piece in Ohio, which is about 500 feet long, and it covers the entire side of the freeway in the neighborhood that acts as a real urban divide between the rest of Ohio City and Lakeview Terrace public housing. And so that was, I think, really one of the kind of very powerful ways that we felt like this project, which really was just creating a number of murals and large-scale public art pieces, could really kind of become a bit of a catalyst and a voice for thinking about how to bridge this sort of divide in our neighborhood and try to kind of really bring organizations and bring the community together. And I think it's been actually really successful. And, you know, I almost every day see people kind of taking selfies in front of the art and taking tours and taking people around. So I think in that way, it's actually been really successful in that.
Well, and a number of you have worked in that public art space and in the reinvigoration of, or in the invigoration of a really robust public art or arts program. Whether it's the new spaces, which I know is in Hinchtown, correct? And then there's also Creative Fusion. I'm never going to get this right. Interurban. Thank you. That's good. So the arts, obviously, are a key driver here. The arts are not always a key driver in certain cities. Why is it that here the arts are that kind of driver? Lillian, can you or Jennifer or others speak to that?
I think it's just, for me, it's been really thinking about the fact that we don't think about artists over here, public art over here. It's actually just a better way of doing business to really think about things on all levels in terms of who's designing it, who's involved in it, how's it get done, how you really, really think about why you're doing something. And so it's how I operate. It's sort of like the arts aren't over here and design and architecture's over here, or the way we make our city. It's about ensuring that in everything we do, and I think we all probably feel this way, is that we're kind of operating on every level at every given time with every given opportunity to include creative professionals, creative people in this city.
I just add quickly, I mean, I think one of the real reasons, of course, is that there's just money that flows in this direction. The Cleveland and Gunn Foundation have supported the arts for generations. Cuyahoga Arts and Culture, thank you, cigarette smokers. I mean, when there are resources, that's how things get done, and I think that that's been a big part of the, kind of climate here.
Right, and you have to look at the last 100 years. I mean, we have excellence and century-old art institutions, and that casts a long shadow on how we perceive the importance of arts. So the way I think it's become more democratized, if you will, in the last couple of decades, but really this is something that if you are a Clevelander, you've grown up with art.
And you have, obviously we're sitting in a space that's critical to that because of the contemporary art that happens here. And if it weren't for MoCA as an anchor, as well as the Cleveland Museum, if it weren't for the other spaces that are being developed now, or I had the opportunity to see Transformer when I was here last. All that is, that truly does go into the mix. And part of what gives me hope is that if you're surrounded by art, even if your schools don't provide it, there's a feeling that you can be a creative being. And there's also that sense that art is central to life, which has been somewhat taken away by the federal government and the way it talks about the arts in relationship to education, in relationship to its priority, even in the hierarchy of learning, et cetera. So I think that the idea that there is this envelopment that is the arts is something that Cleveland could show, frankly, my part of the world. It's just amazing.
Yeah, I would just add that I think, you know, we do, there's a sophistication in our philanthropic community that is so crucial. And again, it's the history with the large institutions, but there's also this recognition that it's the layering of things that's important. Public square is fantastic, it's not gonna save the world. You know, there's not a silver bullet that's gonna turn the city around, but it's the layering and some of the temporary and permanent art installations you can do. Exactly what you said, they elevate. One of my favorite projects ever was the first project I ever worked with Lillian on, which was this beautiful 530-foot linear fence around a school in Ohio City when we were building playgrounds. And we were smart. We said, we're gonna spend $40,000 on a fence. Let's spend $65,000 and do it awesome. And the artist came, and it's literally like these stick figures that show what should be happening in a school ground. And Steve Litt, have you heard of him? He called it a deliriously joyful parade of life. And to me, it's, I'll never forget when it went in, neighbors came up to us and said, is this for us? It's this notion of elevating in the everyday, and it's the notion of having partners and organizations and funders in the city and others who understand murals do one thing, public square done well does another thing, and it's the layering of all these kinds of things that's gonna bring the city back.
The funding is amazing here, but then there are, Terry, projects that are currently planning, in planning or underway or even stymied that involve the arts and other sorts of other disciplines that need to be reinvigorated. You have at least one of those that you think about a lot, which was the Detroit Superior project.
Yeah, I mean, I think that, I mean, probably at the urban design scale, urban development scale, it's not really about projects, it's about process, you know? And so, I mean, even things, projects that we think are done, Public Square, maybe have some things still left to resolve, I'm just saying. So, but I think that's what we need to think about the city, is that even if it's finished, it's not finished because the city around it changes. And so that, so I don't really sort of see any project as stymied, it's just not done yet. So I'm glad you mentioned Public Square, captive audience. I mean, it's a project that the Design Collaborative has been really interested in for a long time. That lower level of the bridge is one of the city's most spectacular public spaces, except that it's not open to the public. And the only reason I think it fits in this context is that it's right between Hinchtown and Public Square. See, so I'm seated perfectly here for this. The nice thing about the bridge is it's not going anywhere. Eventually, people in the city will recognize that that's a space that belongs to the people, and we'll find a way to get it open. Until then, you know, we've got lots of stuff we can be doing.
And I was reading about the Opportunity Corridor, and you had some things to say about that. Perhaps that'll be afterward?
Yeah, maybe that's a whole different session. Yeah. But when we think about Opportunity Corridor, it's going to be 30 years before Opportunity Corridor perhaps is built out. And so the design decisions that happen, not the big design decisions, but the thousands of decisions that are going to unfold over the next years and decades are really critical to the shape of that entire neighborhood, and I would argue the whole city. That's a conversation. Sorry. Go ahead.
I was going to say, one of the kind of really important things that Terry has done over the last few years has been to raise this question of how are we spending this $3 billion of sewer district infrastructure dollars. I say this because people don't really recognize where ratepayer money is going to get rid of all of our gray infrastructure in the city for stormwater. And it's $3 billion over 25 years. It is the largest infrastructure investment of our lifetimes and really could be leveraged. And so she's been really asking the questions about how can that be spent? How can we really think about a whole system of new public spaces, of green infrastructure? And I think, to be honest, I think that's one for me that I think needs to resurface in this community, and we really need to make sure that we don't look back 100 years from now and say we missed the one opportunity to create a kind of completely connected network of parks and systems in the city of Cleveland. And so it's one that is in the midst of what we're seeing go on today, and I think we have good leadership and new leadership at the sewer district. And so I don't know if I want to put you on the spot, if you can talk about that.
I love that you use the word resurface, because that's sort of the fundamental part of it, is that we can spend $3 billion underground where no one can see it, or maybe some of that money and, you know, kind of water could possibly resurface. I think it's a long conversation, but one that really needs to be had. you know, I think that sometimes I hate being the person who's always like saying that we're not doing things well enough, but we always have to ask the question of how can we do things better than we are, and particularly when so many public dollars are being spent, we all, you all, and people who are not in this room need to be part of that conversation.
And everybody here knows the Opportunity Corridor. Everyone understands what that is? Okay, I just want to check, because I had to learn about it. So I just wanted to make sure. So I could see a beautiful catena d'acqua all over the city. It would be great to go from that Italian model of garden architecture to something that could truly be enjoyed by everybody. So the question I come to is the big question, which we talked about a little bit just now with the corridor, which is the future, obviously, and the type of leadership required, the public policies that are needed to drive that change. Do we have those things in place? Is it something that has to be worked on? How is that generational shift going to actually make this city, again, make that next leap forward? Because the last 20 years have been so astonishing. It's an open question.
Well, I hope what we've done with some of the projects, large and small, that have been completed is really create a market for this. And, you know, you've got some mighty women on this stage, but we can't do it by ourselves. I mean, this community has to demand more. And this community has to understand the impact that these projects have in revitalizing and driving dollars. We raise money for Public Square and everything else we've ever done by really demonstrating that these investments bring additional economic development. It's what makes cities competitive. And when you do them well, it makes them more so. So I think it's a combination of, you know, public policy, the continued leadership and kind of questioning of the philanthropic community. And it's, if you look at the folks on the stage, everyone plays a different role. You've got folks who have been part of design bodies, who are leaders in philanthropy, who are individual developers, an organization that just kind of builds stuff. And Terry's really, really critical role of saying, what are we doing and should we do it differently? I mean, so there's lots of different pieces to the food chain, and I think a healthy community needs that, but it, at this point, with people can start to see the results of what some of the things that have happened over the last decade, the community has to demand more from their elected leaders, from themselves. I mean, I think it's you know, there's a point where you can catalyze, and you do need leadership to continue to carry things through, but we've set the stage, and it remains to be seen if we can identify the next really critical things that are needed to propel us forward.
And one of the things that we're sort of in a renaissance is our public spaces. I mean, it started with Perk Park and what we were doing downtown, Public Square. But then the key is what's happening in the neighborhoods with our parks. And it boils down always to people. People, people, people. You cannot say it more than enough. For people to look, no matter where they live in the city, how to demand a certain quality of life that should not be based on anyone's economic situation. So we've got very sleepy, small pocket parks that could turn into something completely transformative and lovely. We have recreation centers that we're very slowly starting to see some transformation in our civic recreation centers. So these are the things that can happen all over. You know, right now, Cleveland is really kind of working on its low-hanging fruit and its most public spaces. But as it starts to go into our neighborhoods, and we can still demand and know what a certain quality of life is and actually make it happen. And that could be demanding from City Hall, but it also could be working on your own, getting a certain amount of knowledge. I think Hingetown is a great example of showing how taking some development that was occurring that happened to be mostly art-based and turning it into a neighborhood. And it is still, I mean, it's not in no ways, you know, complete at this point. There's a lot of very interesting things that are in the pipeline. But that could happen anywhere. It could happen in Buckeye. It can happen in Glenville. It can continue to happen in Detroit Shoreway. There's constant moving that we just have to make sure it continues to. And that can only happen not by five people on a panel, but by the 250,000 people or more that live in our neighborhoods.
I think, you know, one thing Lily and your predecessor, Kathleen Cervini, had talked about publicly was the idea of a kind of high up cabinet level position at City Hall that could be some kind of public arts director. Ann Zoller.
she's running for mayor.
Thank you.
But I do think that it would be really helpful to have that kind of leadership. I mean, we have been really lucky to get a lot of support from people like Ashley Shaw at Ohio City Incorporated, Tom McNair, Joe Simperman, and Carrie McCormack, our former and current council people. But I think having that sort of leadership, really pushing and fast-tracking arts projects, because it's not always that easy to get these things through, would be something that you know, I don't know, you could never quantify how many projects didn't happen because they didn't have enough support or leadership at the city level, but it seems like something that would be really beneficial for some of these projects.
And aren't the different foundations helping to fill that gap at this point?
Well, in Land's studio, I mean, I think that's a big part of what Land does is steps up and, you know, kind of advances certain projects. And I think, you know, it's a good time to be having this conversation. I'm sure you all remember that just a few months ago, you know, we passed this new income tax increase here. And so the city actually has resources and is planning, at least as I understand it, to make some investments in neighborhood parks. And I think understanding, you know, kind of what design quality means across the demographic spectrum is really important. Because I guess I'm going to argue with you, Jennifer, that Hingetown probably couldn't happen anywhere. It's a pretty income-specific, place-specific kind of...
But there are other, not necessarily Hingetown, and that's the key thing about Cleveland is that there can't be a Detroit Shoreway. A lot of folks like to say, well, we want to put Detroit Shoreway in our neighborhood. No, it is whatever your neighborhood, whatever that DNA is, will inform what that is. Yeah. So Hingetown was informed because of the magic that was happening at that point in a very specific way, just like Detroit Shoreway became a certain thing, just like Collinwood has a definite personality.
And Glenville.
And Glenville is starting. Mm-hmm. And I don't think we've even tapped what Glenville can be. Right. So, and other neighborhoods, I think it's what the beauty is, however many neighborhoods we have, that's how many different sort of arts focus perspectives that we can get.
But I think it's important to understand the role that Marika and Graham have played. You have two individuals that have come in, they were not asked, I'm sure they were told no. I think when they came out with the Hingetown people thought like, well, who gave you the right to name a neighborhood? And they just did it, and look at what they've done. And I think when you talk about the kind of leadership needed going forward, you need the public sector, you need philanthropists, you need the little engine that could type nonprofits that just drive these things, but you need developers who hold design at a very, very high level and are gonna swing a big bat and say, we're in. And you know, so you guys should really be saluted for having the vision, sticking to it. That's the kind of thing we need to see replicated. And Jennifer, just as you're saying, as it should be individually across the city, not in a cookie cutter fashion. The last thing that you guys have done have been cookie cutter. I mean, but it's how do you, you know, the price of entry in Cleveland is relatively low compared to other markets. How do you entice people to make those kinds of investments that we hope really can be good business?
I actually had a question for Susan, and maybe for the panel, because I thought about it a lot as I was preparing. And I don't know how I feel about it, actually, so I can't believe I'm going to ask it. But
we would reveal things about ourselves in this. So
is there something about sort of this question about women in design and that you would say that, and would we say that there's something that is unique or different about Cleveland to have so many women on this stage and women out here that I see, especially young leaders that are women in this community that are doing things and getting things done, that translates into something different about making cities?
Sorry. It's okay. You know, I think that I'm, as a thinker, I'm different than that. I look more at the idea of a Venn diagram, and when I feel that women are left out of things, I try to bring forward the idea that women are these incredible producers. and these incredible minds. And so when I started this project about women, arts, and social change as an initiative, it was because I realized that when arts were talked about and social change was talked about, women were always left out of that picture. And when women were talked about and social change was talked about, the arts were always left out of the picture. So I decided, okay, I can see that Venn diagram. Let's put that back in so that women are seen as having these critical roles. So in many ways, it was filling that gap that made that center of the Venn diagram work, which is why I started this. But in working with the Ohio Advisory Group and in talking with Barbara, there seemed to be this group of women who were obviously involved with a whole cadre of folks who were across the spectrum, let's say, and people who self-identify as women, as well as people who are biologically women to begin with. And so my whole idea is just that, can we bring forward these women who are doing these great things? I don't think about it as a larger sense that it's just women doing this stuff. I think that would be hard, but I do feel that when women are involved in great public projects, in making that kind of change, that they should receive the recognition they deserve. And this is an incredible example of that.
And the reason I ask is that probably for the up until the last 50 years, women have not been historically architects or involved in certain kind of especially public sector roles that have done this work. So I think the question for us is, will that matter? And you know, what will we do that is different as women? And as I said, I don't know how I feel about that, but it's kind of an interesting change because I think it's here to stay.
Well, I think it is taking, enabling yourself to take a territory that frankly has been colonized by another. And so I think it's an important moment to do that. I also think that I was thinking about this in terms of something Terry had written, which was that the next step may be not to consider Cleveland or Detroit or other cities as being rivals for how many people will come here or what who's number one in what ranking or where you stand, but rather that when are the cities going to work together in a way that really makes a difference in terms of overall concepts, and how do you deal with issues of wastewater? Where did the monies come from? What is the driver for these things on a much larger public scale within the United States? And I think that's an interesting. I think that that's that kind of next step that I just was immediately struck by, and so maybe that's the next step for all of us to think about. And Barbara tells me time is up. So thank you to our panelists. It's a very quick 45 minutes to an hour. And I'm so grateful to all of you for being here. And we look forward to more conversation during the Catalyst Cocktail Hour. Thank you so much.